We're going to spend this morning on the uniqueness of creation. And Lucy asked me last week, so what's going to be the title of your sermon? And I said, the title is The Problem with Peacocks. And she said, oh no. So I hope that by the end of this sermon, you will consider that peacocks are quite a problem to not only those people that own them, oh my goodness, but really to the point of this sermon this morning, and that is to those that aren't endowed with the understanding of intelligent design. So we're going to turn to Psalm 139. We're going to look at some of those verses there, not all of that amazing psalm. But we note as we begin in verse 1, or prior to verse 1, that this is a psalm of David. And it is given to the chief musician as a hymn. It's intended to be sung by the congregation. We don't know what age David was when he penned this psalm. We do know that David likely penned some of his psalms very early in life as he, sitting out in the shepherd's fields, was impressed by the omniscience and the presence and the power of God, allowing him to oversee these animals that were so similar to human beings. We begin in verse 1 when David writes, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thought afar off. You comprehend my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. There is not even a word upon my tongue, but behold, O Lord, you know it all together. You have hedged me behind and before, and you've laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall fall on me, even the night shall be light about me. Indeed, the darkness shall not hide from you, but the night shines as the day. Verse 13. For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. To David, there was this very unique and quite intimate personal understanding that he was somebody in his mother's womb. He was endowed, as it were, and he'll speak concerning his spirit and his soul, knowing of God's handiwork while he was in his womb. I would dare say that none of us remember those experiences, though it could be possible that you may, because they say that in the mother's womb, we as human beings are aware of so many things that are going on outside the womb. And for Lucy and I, we would often sing to our children in the womb. We would read the word. We would pray with our babies in the womb because we knew that this is something God has done. This is something God has wrought. We took a part or a little position in this, but it's really that you did it, God. And David says, you formed me. You formed my inward parts. In other words, the things that David could not see. David wasn't a physician, certainly not a surgeon. And although he was well aware of working with sheep and lambs and, you know, birthing and issues like that, he wondered about the things that were within him. And in Judaic thought, they positioned certain thoughts and the heart of man and the things of their inward as things that could compel their lives to respond and could compel God, and God compelled inward things within us. And he said, God, you're the one that formed my inward parts, and you covered me, kind of like a blanket in my mother's womb. I love that. I love the thought of that, how God keeps us warm and snug as a bug in a rug, you know, in our mother's womb. I don't personally remember any of that. But Spurgeon, interestingly enough, said this with respect to verse 13. He said, Thou art, O God, the owner of my inward parts, my passions, not the indweller and observer only, but the acknowledged Lord and possessor of my most secret self. This God doth not only inspect and visit, but it is his own. He is as much at home there as a landlord would be in his own estate or a proprietor in his own house. God loves to take part in your inward parts. There is nothing, no door closed that cannot be opened and no inward part that he can't be a part of. So when we pray for healing or we pray for God to come with his intelligent design and perhaps right or wrong or, you know, look at your blueprints and obviously this is wrong, God says, yes, I know. I know exactly where that is. And I'm prepared to deal personally, intimately, and quite remotely to your understanding with exactly the issue that is there. Verse 14 of Psalm 139. And I will praise you, David writes, he sings, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. There certainly were scientists in David's day, physicians, etc., that had certain thoughts and sometimes superstitious ideas about what would heal or how people were made. It seems as though David clearly understood that it was God that made his inward parts, though I suspect David had never seen them. But he's seen the inward parts of a lamb. He's seen the inward parts of sheep, I suppose, that attacked by wolves, as Lucy and I did with our flock, are wounded gravely. And you wonder, Lord, how does all this work inside? How is it that we as human beings live as long as we do? It's an astonishing thing. And he says, that my soul knows very well. Intelligent, specific, and intimate design. Spurgeon also said, who can gaze even upon a model of our anatomy without wonder and awe? Who could dissect a portion of the human frame without marveling at its delicacy and trembling at its frailty? Any parent that's had a child in emergency room or a child that's broken a bone or something like that, certainly every parent would wish that if possible, the parent could take the place of that child. I have certainly done that. And God's love for that child is no different than his love for us. And his interest in healing is one that's perfect. I do believe God heals. He heals today. But he has an agenda. He has things that are going on that we don't see beyond the veil of our own personal little realm. And sometimes we wonder why God takes time or why God does certain things. We might ask, where were you? Did this surprise you? And of course, it's not possible for God not to see or not to participate. He's there. My frame, my substance, verse 15 and 16, was not hidden from you when I was made in secret. Listen, your frame, your substance, the things that make you up are not hidden from God either. There's nothing hidden, not even darkness can hide the things that lie within you. And we marvel at its workings. We marvel, in fact, at the degree to which science has accomplished such surgical procedures who came up with that, you know? Who came up with that? I always joke with my wife, who split the first watermelon open and said, good? God has led us, has he not? He's informed us, has he not? He's cared for us. For your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed, and in your book they are all written, the days fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them. Is it possible God knows who you are, where you would live, what would make up your body, your age, your location, your gender, etc., long before he had created anything? It seems that Scripture very clearly declares such things. God is not surprised by the conception of any human being. And I would dare say there are no illegitimate children. None. It's not as though God says, how'd that happen? We know how it happens. We know how he wants us in an intimate married relationship to be involved with his handiwork so that the child comes forth in a loving environment where parents have not only dedicated themselves to the Lord, but they've dedicated themselves to each other. And there's this sense about them that if God blesses, that we will indeed do as he commanded Adam and Eve, multiply and fill this earth. We raise Christian children because we want to see the Church of Jesus Christ continue in its dominion over all things, particularly the gates of hell. How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God, and how great is the sum of them. If I should count them, they would be more in number than the sand. When I awake, I am still with you. Are you surprised when you wake up and, whoo, hey, still here. Hallelujah. Where's the coffee? You know, that kind of thing. I am surprised. I'm getting to the age where every morning's a blessing. It's like a gift that has to be slowly opened, right? Thank you, Jesus. But when we consider that David, not as a scientist, not as a surgeon, not as a biology teacher, one that's really ever even, I suppose, looked at the anatomy of man, for Jews were by Levitical law forbidden to approach a grave or even touch a dead person. That there was something about this intimate relationship with David in the wilderness of Bethlehem that solidified this keen understanding that, oh my goodness, God, you are the one. Literally, it says that you crocheted our bones together in my mother's womb. And so it strikes me with fear, with awe, with reverence, with an understanding that you, God, are capable of things that man will never be able to accomplish. Indeed, even scientists today, acting as they suppose themselves to be gods, not all scientists, but some suppose that they're the ones that will be able to create life. They've reported that they have replaced a sheep's blood with human blood. They've reported to put human hearts into baboons and keep them alive. Scientists are thinking in realms not of benefiting humanity, but rather thinking of themselves as, I'm Nimrod, and my throne will be above your throne. I don't know why, but as a young man, as I went through high school and was approaching college and trying to consider what would be my career, what would be the realm in which I would have great joy in doing something. Well, as probably a very unique niche, considering the fact that I was raised in Coronado, an island 50 feet from the water. Later, entering into junior college and then college, I pursued wanting to become a veterinarian, but not just a vet, but a subset of that, a large animal vet, a further subset, an equine large animal vet, but even further, a equine large animal vet working at a racetrack. And that may seem funny, but that to me was like, that's the top of the pyramid. I mean, because the vets at the racetracks are they're almost deified in because these animals are so valuable. And as I went on to Cal Poly, pursuing getting into veterinary school, hopefully UC Davis Veterinary School, I discovered not long into this pursuit that I of course, would be unsuitable in the eyes of the medical school because as a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant human being in the early 70s, it would be without a clear 4.0 and perhaps the recommendation of a senator or the president or, I don't know, the King of England, it would be near impossible for me to get in. I pursued it anyways. My degree, interestingly enough, is in veterinary science as a Bachelor of Science degree. And I mention that to you because the things I learned there in the classes that were so unique to that pursuit were classes that fascinated me as a young Christian. I was a very young Christian when I was given the tremendous privilege of working at the W. Kellogg Arabian Horse Center at Cal Poly. I lived there for several years, worked there, became the foreman of the site. And in the process of taking classes like equine embryology, how many of you took that? One? No. Okay. I learned things that fascinated me, and it fascinated me beyond even what I felt like the professor was fascinated by. And there were times when he would equate things, and I think maybe they were forced to in those days, certainly are today. It's not politically correct to even mention intelligent design or creationism. And it seems so even in Christian colleges anymore. But he would mention something about, you know, primordial soup or, you know, this happen chance of stuff. And I'd say, really, think about what you're saying. I pretty much marked myself as, you know, the goon Christian in the class. But I think it solicited certain feverish discussion at times. And I can remember at least once him telling me just to shut up and sit down. But when you look at embryology and the formation from a sperm and an ovum, no matter where in not only animal life, but also in us human beings, you can't possibly not be fascinated by what occurs rather quickly once a specific sperm is allowed to break its way into the core of the ovum. I don't know how that works. I think God is clearly a part of that, and thus gender is determined even previous to that conception in the ovum. And it strikes me as we studied so minutely into the realm of even horses as the mares are impregnated, and then comes the foaling. And I working at the Kellogg Arabian Horse Center, it was very common, friends, to be working with multi-million dollar animals. In the Arabian horse field, and I suppose this is true in quarter horses or standard breds or thoroughbreds, etc., there are extremely valuable animals that have in their conformation and in the manner in which they carry themselves certain pedigree and attributes, characteristics that everyone wants a part of. And even over in Santa Ynez Valley, where one of the top Arabian horse centers, breeding farms is, it would be common for us to get mares that wanted the Basque, that's the name of the stud, bloodlines in their mare. And the stud fee was $1 million. In 1973, $1 million. Now that kind of separates the men from the boys, doesn't it? And these mares would show up that were worth millions of dollars in themselves because they had begotten, they had foaled animals that had been raised to be showstoppers, great, great animals, and they would come to be bred by one of our stallions that were direct inheritors of the Basque bloodline from Santa Ynez. And we would go through the stallion covering the mare, and we would go through keeping the mare for several months, that $1 million guaranteed a foal. And whether it would be a colt or a filly, not every foal is a colt, okay? Let's get that straight. Oh, my mare had a colt. Oh, really? A male? No. Well, then you really don't know what you're talking about, do you, dear? I'm not usually that confrontive. Late at night, typically in the wee hours of the morning, between 12 and 2 in the morning, I would be sitting with a mare in the birthing paddock. And she would be moaning and groaning. We knew that it was time for her because it would always be 7 months, 7 weeks, and 7 days, which is exactly the pregnancy length of a human being as well. And we would wait for the day, and then I would, as the foreman of the unit, I would be there with her. And it was such a beautiful thing because, of course, her water would break, and as she laid down, these little feet would come out of the womb. And you'd see these little feet, which were so unique. And that was one of the first times, as a Christian, I just began to cry. Here comes this foal that is, at its birth, worth several million dollars. There would be a veterinarian present on site, but of course he would be asleep. And if something came up, I'd have to call him real quick. And as the foal would come, it's two front hooves would be covered with these little shoes of cartilage. Not the hoof itself, but a little shoe, like an overshoe, like a galosh, like a welly. And out would come the nose, and you could see the nostrils of the nose just start to flare as soon as it was out of the womb. And out would come this beautiful little creature. And we'd get the foal up, and it would just immediately go for its mother's mammaries and just begin to nurse with fervor and just really hurt the mare at first. And hook up, and then you knew, because as soon as you saw the tail go like this, they got what they were looking for. And within an hour of birth, these little cartilage galoshes would just fall off. And I thought, Lord, within the womb, those hooves uncovered could cut the uterus open. But you provided, Father. And other members of the staff at the horse center would come in, and they'd see me crying, and I wasn't embarrassed because I just thought, this is something God has wrought. Nothing compares, of course, to a father and a mother for the first time seeing their child come forth from your wife's womb. It's something. I'm here to say to you that we are unique in our creation. We are unique even through the birth process. We are unique in the birth process itself. My wife loves to take part in birthings. If you need a spectator, give her a call. She'd surely come, I'm telling you. And here's the thing. We're all so unique. And in fact, Scripture confirms and repeats this comment with regard to us that we are unique in our creation. Every one of us are unique. And so much so, friends, that none of us share the exact same DNA in this room. We are all uniquely endowed with a DNA codex that identifies us apart from every other human being that not only is alive today, but has ever lived. Ever lived. Every cell of this trillion cell body that is so beautiful this morning, by the way, and you smell quite nice. Every cell carries within it this DNA coding that identifies you apart from everyone else. And thus, the law enforcement agencies use that DNA to be able to identify you apart from every other human being on earth, and can tell from your hair, from your saliva, from even drinking from a Coke bottle. They can swipe the DNA and identify, you're the one that drank my Coke. Yeah. It's intriguing, and this is all part of God's intelligent design. At Walt Disney World in Orlando is an obelisk of sorts. It's something that stands in the air. It's 70-something feet high. And it depicts the DNA of the DNA library of every cell of your body. And what's intriguing to me about that is, it is God who formed your inward parts. Now, you might say that the chromosomes, and you might say that, you know, the primordial soup or the alien object, or there's all kinds of manners that goofballs that just can't give glory to God would commit themselves to how we got where we are. But I want to say to you this morning, this is the problem of peacocks, but it's also the problem of intelligent design in our human bodies, is that you are unique. And there are certain systems within your body that are called irreducible mechanisms. It's a mechanism that cannot be reduced any further. In other words, if a part of that mechanism would be removed, the mechanism would not work at all. It means that in the creation, in the design of that mechanism, every single part had to be there and could not evolve from, you know, a glob of cartilage. It had to be intelligently placed in its position and in its design for it to ever work at all. In John chapter 3, verse 16, it's clear that God wants us to know that His Son, Jesus, in some versions referred to as the only begotten, in this version, the Lexham English Bible, it says, "For in this way God loved the world so that He gave His one and only Son, in order that everyone who believes in Him will not perish but have eternal life." The original verbiage speaks to something unique, something special, something that could not in its entirety ever be reproduced. Kind of like we've been told regarding a snowflake. They're all different. You are unique. You are different, but you're special in the eyes of the Lord because He was there when you were endowed with life. In fact, Peter somehow knew this when in Matthew 16 at Caesarea Philippi, Jesus is walking past the Via Mar, one of the highest traveled, unique roads, you might call Highway 1 of Israel. And it's there passing by what Jesus would later refer to as the gates of hell, that Jesus asks His disciples following Him at that point, that certainly are over 12 people, could be as many as 100 or 120, because he soon sets his face steadfast towards Jerusalem. In other words, I have one mission, I'm heading towards there. But he asks his disciples, who do others say that I am? And they repeat some interesting responses. Well, you're Jeremiah, you're Elijah. Earlier, he was suggested as being John the Baptist, an incarnation, a reincarnation of sorts. And then most importantly, he asks a question that is personal and is directive as he turns to his disciples alone and he says, who do you say that I am? You've been with me for almost 2 years. You've seen endless miracles. You have seen endless demons report even in seeing me. Why have you come to vex me, as the demons in Legion screamed, arriving on the shore of the Gadarenes? They have witnessed things that human beings like us, I would long to see. They've witnessed resurrections. They've witnessed truly infirmed people, paralyzed people, blind people, lame people, lepers, all come into perfect life as Jesus, the designer of all things, impressed the blueprint back on them once again and said, no, this is how I made you, and this is how you shall live. I love that. And I love the fact that as Peter responds, he responds with something that's so much deeper than just the plain English reveals to us. He says, you are the Messiah. The term Christ really wasn't part of Grecian language, certainly not popular in its usage. So in the Aramaic, as Peter responds to Jesus, he's certainly using the term, you are the Messiah. But even more important than that, particularly to this morning's sermon, and that's my point I'm making, he says, you are the Son of the living God. And that is granted. We know that. We know that now in retrospect because we have loved the Word, and the Word has become flesh, and we have beheld His glory. But for Peter, I believe, prior to the time when he truly believed on Jesus, particularly as a Savior, to mention it in that manner, really in the Aramaic, refers to God Creator, the breather of life into all things. That's really, literally, what Peter said. And Jesus is a bit, it's like, wow. You know, Peter, flesh and blood hasn't revealed this to you, but the Spirit of the living God has revealed this to you. And Peter's a bit taken back and then takes, you know, his trophy and, you know, kind of wears and bears it to his own ignorance later on. But what Peter is saying about Jesus is that God, in his omniscience and omnipresence, was there in the womb when your father and your mother participated in that which God created them to participate in the matrimony of one marriage to a male and a female with the blessing of the covenant as long as they both shall live to be people that love the Lord. And I don't know at what point that happens, but it must be at the point of conception. And that would be the point when the sperm finally winds its way into the ovum. And there begins something that scientists are in awe of. They don't even understand how a seed that appears to be dead can be put into the soil 1,000 years later and rise because life is still in it. They don't understand that. They want to, because they want to be gods. And Jesus breathes life. And David said, this my soul knows very well. I love you, Lord. I can see him sitting on a rock in the shepherd's fields of Bethlehem. Been there many times. My son has been with me many times. And just sitting on that rock and just looking into heaven and going, Lord, I am so fearfully and wonderfully made. It is you that gave me this heart for you. And I'm impressed. Impressed to the point where I'm penning a poem that is intended to be a song of worship before you. Oh, is there any greater calling than that? Writer of Hebrews mentions this with respect to Abraham's son, Isaac. And the verbiage in Hebrews 11, verse 17 is unique because I want you to see, once again, God is calling each of us unique. Even though you may have several children, each one of them unique and beloved of God, and certainly beloved of you as well. Hebrews 11, verse 17, by faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered Isaac, and the one who received the promises was ready to offer his one and only son. Now, Abraham, didn't you remember that several years earlier, the handmaiden by the name of Hagar to Sarai was offered to you to bear a son because Sarai could not. And she bore the son Ishmael. There's something so powerful about that name. This Saturday at the men's breakfast, I'm going to kind of let that blossom unfold for you. It's so, so good for us. No, he knew about his son Ishmael. But in that confluence of things that were happening so quickly, Abraham wasn't necessarily prepared at the moment that he drew his obsidian knife to the throat of his son as he was bound upon the rock with the thrushes about him to be a burnt offering to his God. He did all that God called him to. And I can see the father taking the knife to his son's throat and finally hearing from heaven, Abraham, stop! For I have provided for you one that will take his stead. His special son, his unique son. You are a special son and daughter. It's repeated again in Romans 8, 7 and 32. And this is where we come to the problem of peacocks. A wonderful book entitled The Hallmarks of Design, written by Stuart Burgess, who is a professor, as I understand, Connor, at the University of Bristol, England, where Connor and Hannah had planted a church. And he has written a book that describes, as it were, creation and the intricacies of creation that seem to be solely for the benefit of God himself and you and I, who he has created in his image and likeness. We see a peacock's feather and we see the beautiful iris of a pretty girl. And both of these created solely for the benefit of those that would look upon it. He mentions 10 particular characteristics of the human being that are very unique. We're short of time. And let me say, first of all, our upright statue. No other creatures on earth walk primarily in an upright structure. And it's because of the design of our anatomy. We have very specialized and skillful hands that because they are not allowing, we don't need them to find balance as we propel ourselves. They can be used for very specific things. And the number of nerve endings in each of your fingers is astronomical. The design of our palm, the opposing thumbs, all designed by God to do something very specific. There are these calculations that are made in your hand the instant you pick up a baseball bat. Now, it's a very specialized tool, isn't it? You're not going to taste it. Doesn't taste too good. Because you're not even thinking, I'm going to eat that thing. You're not even smelling it. But as you pick up that baseball bat, you're immediately, by the weight of it lying in your palm, and against the muscles of your forearm, your elbow, your biceps, your triceps, etc., all sending messages in an instant, at the speed of light, to this mass within this skull. And by the way, the human brain is by far, scientists, even evolutionists would say, it is the most complex thing in all of the universe, because we don't understand it. In fact, one scientist, not a creationist, said that if he were to begin to number the number, let me put it in these terms, a number of wires leading out of our cerebral cortex down our spinal column, if he numbered each fiber one a second, he numbered one every second, it would take him 1 million years to count them all. It's beyond the scope of mathematics. They don't know how this thing works, and yet they believe it crawled out of the primordial soup after some alien ship dropped an organism on the earth some billions and billions of years ago. We have a unique intellect. We have the capacity to be able to, in this anatomical, you know, frame, to hold ourselves in balance. And it's all because of these little hairs inside the tubes of your ear and in the movement of our head. It's sending mathematical computations to our brain that instructs our entire anatomy and the ligaments and the tendons and the muscles to respond, to return us, if we desire, back to a balanced position. How does this happen? I want to say that there, in irreducible mechanisms, it's clear that our number, the eyeball, is an irreducible mechanism. By the way, also the human knee is an irreducible mechanism. In that, every portion of the human knee had to be existing upon its creation. It couldn't have been developed over millions and billions of years. It simply wouldn't work. And if a creature does not have a limb, a joint that works, guess what? That creature is going to be under the foot of the Tyrannosaurus Rex. Simple put. The knee in the human had to be intact as a mechanism that is irreducible upon creation in order for it to work. Scientists say, we don't get it. We don't know. The knee joint was the most complex and bewildering joint in the human body to Charles Darwin. And here we come to peacocks. The problem of peacocks is that they have a feather system that is beautiful. Anyone ever seen a male with its feather system? And peacocks all over the world have very unique feather systems. And when they unfurl their feather plume for the sake of a peahen, what they're attempting to do in its size and its arrangement to woo that peahen to the peacock, right? Well, did you know that every animal besides the human being is entirely colorblind? 100% colorblind. You wave a red cape at a bull, what is he seeing? He's not seeing red. He's seeing something moving. And the grazer's eye is only really capable of seeing well enough when its head is down. This is why grazers, with their heads at the ground, have their best eyesight, and the bull lowers its head. He's just seeing movement, and he's going to attack the movement because that's what bulls do. That's their full-time job. Our eyeballs have the capacity in its rods and its cones in our retina, and the retina is one of the most phenomenally intricate organism in the body because it takes photons of different frequencies, different colors, And that identifies that frequency and tells us that's red, that's black, that's purple, that's green. We learn to name these things as a child, but we recognize colors almost right after you're born. Let's see that video without the sound of a peacock. The feathers of a peacock are translucent in the sense that when light strikes it, it strikes through it and actually reflects to the beholder in a different manner, almost depending on the situation of the peacock. Now, to the peahen, she sees none of that. She doesn't see the translucency. She doesn't see the awesome colors. She just sees black and white, or gray and white, as it were, kind of a grayscale viewpoint. What she's looking for is the size. She's looking at the call of the peacock. She's intrigued by these things, and Darn would admit that this is what brought about what he said would be natural selection, so that way back millions and billions of years ago, the first peacock who had one eyeball on his feathers was superseded by the peacock that had two eyeballs on his feathers. Only for scientists today to look at the feathers of a peacock and say, they are unique to the peacock, they are so obviously different that it's astonishing to us how they were ever created in the first place. And it appears that the peacock's feathers, the sunsets, the sunrises, the iris of our eyes, the beauty of our formation and the wonder of our creation are all for the purpose, friends, of us seeing the beauty of an artist and a sculptor. And for us to stop and just say, oh Lord, I don't want you to ever look at a peacock again and think, oh, isn't evolution just amazing? I want you to look at a peacock. I want you to look into the irises of a beautiful eyeball and say, oh God, you are great. Which means I am unique. I am special. I was created with purpose. I was created with locale. God placed us here. He placed us in this time. He placed us for a purpose. And I want you, dear friends, to think concerning this, because it's 2 minutes after noon. I know that. If you would agree with me that God has created you with intelligent design, and He's created you uniquely, even as David understood, that you understand also this morning that in His purpose for you, it is up to you to decide whether you will give your life into that purpose, or you'll be frustrated with the things that your own flesh desires, perhaps even what the world would dictate. Our God is awesome, and His love for you is particular. It is unique. It is intense. And it is so intimate. So intimate. There is nothing about you He doesn't know, even your thoughts from afar off.